Judah, their encamped between Sokar and Azekah and Ephes Damon. And Saul and the men of Israel were gathered together, and they encamped in the valley of Elah and drew up in battle array against the Philistines. The Philistines stood on a mountain on one side, and Israel stood on a mountain on the other side, with a valley between them. And a champion went out from the camp of the Philistines, named Goliath from Gath, whose height was 6 cubits and a span. That's about 9 feet and 9 inches. and he had a bronze helmet on his head, and he was armed with a coat of mail. And the weight of the coat was 5,000 shekels of bronze, and he had a bronze armor on his legs and a bronze javelin between his shoulders. Now the staff of his spear was like a weaver's beam, and his iron spearhead weighed 600 shekels, and a shield bearer went before him. Then he stood and cried out to the armies of Israel and said to them, "Why have you come out to line up for battle? Am I not a Philistine, and you the servants of Saul? Choose a man for yourselves and let him come down to me. If he is able to fight with me and kill me, then we will be your servants. But if I prevail against him and kill him, then you shall be our servants and serve us." And the Philistines said, "I defy the armies of Israel this day. Give me a man that we may fight together." When Saul and all Israel heard these words of the Philistine, they were dismayed and greatly afraid. Now David was the son of the Ephrathite of Bethlehem, and Judah, whose name was Jesse, and who had 8 sons. And the man was old, advanced in years. In the days of Saul, the 3 oldest sons of Jesse had gone to follow Saul to the battle. The names of his 3 sons who went to the battle were Eliab, the firstborn, next to him, Abinadab, and the third, Shammah. David was the youngest, and the 3 oldest followed Saul, but David occasionally went and returned from Saul to feed his father's sheep at Bethlehem. And the Philistines drew near and presented himself 40 days morning and evening. And Jesse said to his son, "David, now for your brother's ephah of this dried grain and these 10 loaves, and run to your brothers at the camp, and carry these 10 cheeses to the captain of their 1,000, and see how your brothers fare, and bring back news of them." Now Saul and they and all the men of Israel were in the valley of Elah fighting with the Philistines. So David rose early in the morning, left the sheep with a keeper, and took the things, and went as Jesse had commanded him. And he came to the camp as the army was going out to the fight and shouting for the battle, for Israel and the Philistines had drawn up in battle array, army against army. And David left his supplies in the hand of the supply keeper, ran to the army, and came and greeted his brothers. Then as he talked with them, there was the champion, the Philistine of Gath, Goliath by name, coming up from the armies of the Philistines, and he spoke according to the same words. So David heard them, and all the men of Israel, when they saw that man, fled from him, and were dreadfully afraid. So the men of Israel said, "How have you seen this man who has come up? Surely he has come up to defy Israel, and it shall be that the man who kills him, the king, will enrich with great riches, will give him his daughter, and give his father's house exemption from taxes in Israel." Then David spoke to the men who stood by him, saying, "What shall be done for the man who kills the Philistine and takes away the reproach from Israel? For who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God?" And the people answered him in this manner, saying, "So shall it be done for the man who kills him." Now Eliab, his oldest brother, heard when he spoke to the man, and Eliab's anger was aroused against David. And he said, "Why did you come down here? And with whom have you left those few sheep in the wilderness? I know your pride and the insolence of your heart, for you have come down to see the battle." And David said, "What have I done now? Is there not a cause?" And then he turned from him toward another and said the same thing. And these people answered him as the first ones did. Now when the words which David spoke were heard, they reported them to Saul, and he sent for them. Then David said to Saul, "Let no man's heart fail because of him. Your servant will go and fight with this Philistine." And Saul said to David, "You are not able to go against this Philistine to fight with him, for you are a youth, and he a man of war from his youth." But David said to Saul, "Your servant used to keep his father's sheep, and when a lion or a bear came and took a lamb out of the flock, I went after it and struck it and delivered the lamb from its mouth. And when it arose against me, I caught it by its beard and struck it and struck and killed it. Your servant has killed both lion and bear, and this uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them, seeing he has defied the armies of the living God." Moreover, David said, "The Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear, he will deliver me from the hand of the Philistine." And Saul said to David, "Go, and the Lord be with you." So Saul clothed David with his armor and put a bronze helmet on his head. He also clothed him with a coat of mail. David fastened his sword to his armor and tried to walk, for he had not tested them. And David said to Saul, "I cannot walk with these, for I have not tested them." So David took them off. Then he took his staff in his hand, and he chose for him 5 smooth stones from the brook and put them in a shepherd's bag and a pouch which he had. And his sling was in his hand, and he drew near to the Philistine. So the Philistine came and began drawing near to David, and the man who bore the shield went before him. And when the Philistine looked about and saw David, he disdained him, for he was only a youth, ruddy and good-looking. So the Philistine said to David, "Am I a dog that you come to me with sticks?" And the Philistines cursed David by his gods. And the Philistine said to David, "Come to me, and I will give your flesh to the birds of the air and the beasts of the field." And David said to the Philistine, "You come to me with a sword, with a spear, and with a javelin. But I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of armies of Israel, whom you have defiled. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hand, and I will strike you and take your head from you. And this day I will give the carcasses to the camp of the Philistines, to the birds of the air and the beasts of the earth. That all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel. Then all this assembly shall know that the Lord is not saved with sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hands." So it was when the Philistine arose and came and drew near to meet David, that David hurried and ran toward the army to meet the Philistine. Then David put his hand into his bag and took out a stone, and he slung it and struck the Philistine in his forehead, so that the stone sank into his forehead, and he fell on his face to the earth. So David prevailed over the Philistine with a sling and a stone, and struck the Philistine and killed him. But there was no sword in the hand of David. Therefore David ran, stood over the Philistine, took his sword, drew it out of its sheath, and killed him, and cut off his head with it. And when the Philistines saw that their champion was dead, they fled. Now the men of Israel and Judah arose and shouted and pursued the Philistines as far as the entrance of the valley and to the gates of Ekron. And the wounded of the Philistines fell along the road to Shurim, even as far as Gath and Ekron. Then the children of Israel returned from chasing the Philistines, and they plundered their tents. And David took the head of the Philistine and brought it to Jerusalem, but he put his armor in his tent. When Saul saw David going out against the Philistine, he said to Abner, the commander of the army, "Abner, whose son is this youth?" And Abner said, "As your soul lives, O king, I do not know." So the king said, "Inquire whose son this young man is." Then as David returned from the slaughter of the Philistines, Abner took him and brought him before Saul with the head of the Philistine in his hand. And Saul said to him, "Whose son are you, young man?" So David answered, "I am the son of your servant Jesse, the Bethlehemite. Okay. So before David slayed Goliath, God sent the prophet Samuel to David and his family to anoint David to be the next king. And even though David was just a teenager and a shepherd, God still chose him. And he tells us why in verse 7, the chapter before. And it says, "But the Lord said to Samuel, 'Do not look at his appearance or at his physical stature, because I have refused him. For the Lord does not see as man sees, for man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart.'" So obviously the heart is more important than, you know, our physical features, I guess. And David's father told David to bring bread for his brothers at the battleground, they were telling David about like Goliath, and then David was like, what shall be done for this man who kills the Philistine and takes away the reproach from Israel? For who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God? So David's older brother heard him say that, and then his brother heard when he spoke to this man, and Eliab's anger was aroused against David, and he said, why did you come down here, and with whom have you let those few sheep in the wilderness? I know your pride and the insolence of your heart, for you have come down to see the battle. So his brother thought like he was being prideful and conceited, but that wasn't the case. David just knew that the Lord was by his side, and because the Lord was by his side, David was able to, that's why David volunteered to confront and battle Goliath. And when David asked Saul if he could battle Goliath, Saul replied by saying, you are not able to go against this Philistine to fight with him, for you are a youth, and he a man of war from his youth. But David, that didn't stop David. David replied to Saul by saying, the Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear, he will deliver me from the hand of this Philistine. So David knew that the Lord was with him before, so he knew that the Lord would be with him to fight Goliath. So when the Lord is with us, you know, it makes us really strong. And all this reminds me of the lyrics from Our God by Chris Tomlin, which says, if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then who could be against us? And the answer to that is nothing. Thank you.
Amen. And, you know, Paul the Apostle in Romans 8 as well said that if God is for us, then who's against us? Bring it on. And may the Lord help us trust him as David did, and he wasn't afraid. And he continued to say, you know what? I know God is with me. Who is this Philistine that stands against us? So, you can sit in the back, huh? Do you guys remember what Kareem shared from yesterday? The book? You know? Good job. Micah. That's right. Does anyone remember what chapter? 7. That's right. So, let's go to Micah 6. It's one of the, toward the end of the Word of God. And I'm not committing, but I might speak next week about Micah 7. I'll seek the Lord and we'll see. So Micah chapter 6. Micah chapter 6. And if I can have Jonathan Gad come read it for us. Micah 6.
Hear what the Lord says. Arise, plead your case before the mountains, and let the hill near your voice. Let the hills hear your voice. Hear the mountains, the indictment of the Lord, and you enduring fountains of the earth. From the Lord has an indictment against his people, and he will contend with Israel. O my people, what have I done to you? How have I wearied you? Answer me, for I have brought you up from the land of Egypt, and redeemed you from the house of slavery. And I sent you before Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. O my people, remember what Balak, king of Moab, devised, and what Balaam, the son of Beor, answered him, and what happened to the Shittim, to Gilgal, and you know the savings acts of my Lord. With what shall I come before the Lord, bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with the burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleaded with thousands of rams, with 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for the transgressions, the fruit of my body for the sins of my soul? He has told you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you, but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God. The voice of the Lord cries to the city, and it is sound wisdom to fear your name. Hear of the rod and of him who appointed it. Can I forget any longer the treasures of wickedness in the house of the wicked, and the scant measure that is a curse? Shall I quit the man with wicked scales and the bag of deceitful weights? Your rich men are full of violence, your inhabitants speak lies, and their tongue deceitful in their mouth. Therefore I strike you with the grievous blow, making you desolate because of your sins. You shall eat but not be satisfied, and there shall be hunger within you. You shall put away but not preserve, and what you preserve I will give to the sword. You shall sow but not reap. You shall tread olives but not anoint with yourselves with oil. You shall tread grapes but do not drink wine. For you have kept the statutes of Omri and all the works of the house of Ahab, and you have walked in their counsels, that I may make you a desolation and your inhabitants a hissing, so you shall bear the scorn of the people.
Let's pray. Father, thank you for this time. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you that when we come to you on our knees, that you hear us and that you desire an intimate and deep relationship with us, Lord. And we pray that we would come in humility, and we come in submission to you and to your authority and to your goodness, fixing our eyes on you and your beauty, and just desiring that your will would be fulfilled in our lives. We pray that you would speak to us in this time through the word, as you spoke to us through the songs, prayers, and what was shared about your power, that if God is with us, then who's against us? We pray that for your anointing and strength from you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So, Micah, you know, raise your hand if you've ever read Micah. Okay, raise your hand if you didn't even know there was a book called Micah. Okay, that's fair. You know, they call some of the prophets in the Word of God the big prophets, and some are the small prophets. You know, when people say that, you know what they mean? Like, what makes you a big prophet? Is it like a particular height, a particular weight? Is it a particular, the size of the book? That's all it is. So if you actually look, there's lots of small prophets that, like Karim was sharing yesterday, very powerful, but ignored easily because it's very small, and sometimes we read it and kind of like, okay, like, you know, what is going on? What is being shared? What is being said? And we don't understand it, but very powerful. Each one has a specific message that God wants to say. So let me summarize to you Micah. You guys know how many chapters it is? 7. You guys are awesome. 7 chapters. So it's spread. If you wanted to split it, you split it into 3 different sections: chapter 1 and 2, chapter 3 through 5, and chapter 6 and 7. Each one of us tells us about a particular topic. Chapter 1 and 2 says warning. Warning. There's a judgment coming. That's the first message that he wants to share with the people. Then chapter 3 through 5, he says, "I have a promise, though. Even though I just gave you a warning, I want to give you a promise that even though there's judgment coming, there's a deliverer coming. And this deliverer is coming." Then after that, he says, okay, well, now you have to respond. And this is when chapter 6 and 7, he says, "Now I have a challenge for you. A challenge for you, knowing that there's a judgment coming, and knowing that in this judgment, there's also a deliverer coming. How are you going to respond today? What should you do? Not when the judgment comes, not when the deliverer comes, but you know that this is coming and it's coming your way. What do I do right here, right now?" And that's what chapter 6 and chapter 7 is about. You want to summarize it? It's summarized in trust the Lord and obey Him. That's it. What should I do right now, right here, when I know there's judgment coming my way? I need to trust the Lord and obey him. So let's dive into this chapter. Now, as we are reading, you know, anyone here has maybe a potential plan of becoming a lawyer? One. Okay, that means we're going to pick on you. I didn't know if you were going to actually raise your hand or not, but I was going to pick on you anyways. So, lawyer. Now, okay, he wants to be a lawyer. He's not a lawyer yet, so we can't really pick on him that much. So, has anyone been, you don't have to state the reason, but have you ever been to a court? Raise your hand if you've ever actually been to a court and sat, like, in a court session. Okay. So, let's start naming, because I'm going to need your help. I want you guys to preach with me, okay? Because if we understand it, it'd be like, oh, now I get it. Okay, so if you're into law, you better wake up and be excited, because it's exciting stuff. We're going to court right now. So, who do you have in a court? Tell me the main vital people in a court. See, he's polite. He rose his hand. Judge? Okay, there's a judge. Huh? Tina? Plaintiff? Okay, what's a plaintiff? Is that like the defendant? Or, huh? So, like a prosecutor, kind of? This, we're too advanced, Anthony. What's a plaintiff? An officer just to, what's their job? What's a plaintiff's? I'm going to need education. So, what's a plaintiff's job? The defendant. Okay, plaintiff is, it's okay. I didn't even know that there was a word called plaintiff. So, we're you know, I'm worse off. So, plaintiff is a defendant. You guys know what a defendant is? It took me a while to figure that out. No, okay, so can you help say it out so this way I don't say the wrong thing? I can be like, oh yeah, that's what I meant. Right, so the one being accused, right, is the defendant. So the one who is potentially the criminal is the defendant, right? Might not be a criminal, but just potentially is a criminal is the defendant, right? So we got a judge and we got a defendant. And the defendants, now let's not think jury, okay, let's not get complicated, okay, let's think just normal court in most other countries. So you got the defendant's life is in the judge's hand, and then who else do you have? Prosecutor. What does prosecutor want to do? Huh? Put you what? Put you in jail. Who's you? The defendant, okay, not me, man. The defendant. Put the defendant in jail. He wants to get rid of me. Okay, anybody else? Or is this it? There's an officer, okay. The accuser. So but that's kind of the prosecutor, right? So it's the accuser. Huh? The defense. So, but you, okay, well, when the judge listens, right? So the prosecutor goes and says, this person, the defendant, has done this crime. Now, is the judge going to be like, oh, wow, that's so profound. Let me book him for life. Does the judge give a sentence or what do you need? Evidence, right? So, and then you need evidence and you need also, you take part of your evidence is there's this box that you put people into it. Not jury. We said no jury, man, huh? No, not jurors. That's jury. Getting complicated on me. Witnesses, right? All right, so let's try to identify. Let's read this in the first five verses. Let's try to figure out who's the prosecutor, who's the defendant, who's all these things, okay? Hear now what the Lord says. So who's speaking? The Lord. And he says, hear now what the Lord says. It means you and I better what? We better listen, okay? Because this is not what, you know, Mr. So-and-so says. It's not even what Micah says. It's what the Lord says, right? So hear now what the Lord says. Arise, plead your case before the mountains, and let the hills hear your voice. Any ideas? Has there any person come up first? Has any person come up from all these court people? The judge. Who's the judge? Thank you. So the mountains and the hills are the judge, right? So the one who hears your case is what? Is the judge. Arise, plead your case before the mountains, and let the hills hear your voice. Before that, do you know hear your case? Who is this? Who is wanting to present their case? Which is what? Prosecutor? So hear your case. Who is that? Is that the defendant, the prosecutor, the judge the what? So Israel is pleading her case. So Israel is what? Defendant, right? So the criminal is who? Israel. Who's the judge? The mountains and hills. What did you say? I think I'm glad I didn't hear it. What did you say? He's coming. All right, let's read the next part. Hear, O you mountains, the Lord's complaint, and you strong foundations of the earth. For the Lord has a complaint against his people, and he will contend with Israel. Okay, did anyone else get introduced into the picture here in a courtroom? The Lord, what is he? He's the prosecutor, right? He wants who's the defendant? Who's his complaint against? Israel. And who's the judge? The mountains and the hills. Okay, it's not sounding so good right now, right? Imagine this. God says, hey, I have beef with you. And the judge is the mountains and the hills. You know who made them? It's the Lord. And then now he's going to present his case. And then he starts complaining. Oh, my people, what have I done to you? And how have I wearied you? Testify against me. For I brought you up from the land of Egypt, I redeemed you from the house of bondage, and I sent before you Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. O my people, remember now what Balak, king of Moab, counseled, and what Balaam, the son of Beor, answered him from Acacia Grove to Gilgal, that you may know the righteousness of the Lord. Did anyone else get introduced here? What just came up in a courtroom? The witnesses and, what did you say, case? Which means what? Oh, his case. Yeah, he's presenting his case. So he has some witnesses, and he also has, with witnesses, he also has evidence, right? Who are the witnesses, and what's the evidence? Okay, so they are witnesses, and what's the evidence? Okay, verse 5. Very good. So now we have a full court in session, right? We've got a judge. The judge is the mountains and the hills. We've got a defendant, the nation of Israel, God's people. We've got a prosecutor, the Lord himself. And the prosecutor has some pretty hard, good witnesses and some pretty hard evidence. So let's dive into the story. Hear now what the Lord says. Arise, plead your case before the mountains, and let the hills hear your voice. Just come on. Come on, Israel. Come. Just go ahead. Say what you've got. Say what you've got and answer, because I want you to know. Hear, O you mountains. Listen, judge. The Lord's complaint. I have a complaint. Okay, what's your complaint? And you strong foundations of the earth. Okay, as stable as you could be, I want you to know, judge, I want you to know, for the Lord has a complaint, and it's not a generic complaint, it's not a vague complaint, it's a very specific complaint, and it's against a specific people, against his people. And he will contend with Israel. You know what a contend means? Any idea what contend means? Argue. He wants to argue with Israel. And, you know, have you ever heard the word contention? That's what, it's like something is contentious. It's like, oh, this is a lot of arguing and maybe even some fighting back and forth. And here he says, listen, I have a problem with who? Israel, but specifically, what does he call them? His people. That's scary. Because you think, you know, if the Lord has a problem with, you know, the Gentiles, they're not believers. Okay, he should have a problem with them. If the Lord has a problem, let's go back to history. He had a problem with Sodom and Gomorrah. So what?
They deserve it, right? They're living in sin. He had a problem with Egypt when they enslaved the Israelites. Well, they represent the world, and Pharaoh represents Satan. They deserve it. But here, he doesn't have a problem with even Israel. He has a problem with people that he calls his people. You know what he's saying? Is I got some problem, if you want to apply it to today, I have some problem with believers. Whoa. What's your problem, Lord? He says, well, let me tell you what my problem is. For the Lord has a complaint against his people, and he will contend with Israel. And then he says, listen, oh my people, what have I done to you? Okay, I want you to call me out on it, okay? How did I mistreat you? How did I treat you bad? And let me just kind of set the tone of what this means to apply it to us today so that it can hit home. Listen, people of God, you come and worship me. It looks really good on paper. It looks really good by any standard of measurement. And worship, I don't mean music. I'm talking about us worshiping him, meaning we live for him. He says, but I am really bothered by the way you worship me. I'm really bothered by how you are, the state that you are in, and I'm really troubled by you, and I want to know what got you to this state. Why is it that you are so numb? Why is it that you are blah? You look good in church. You look good even outside sometimes, but you're not really there. Your heart is not really completely mine. What has happened to you? Where did I drop the ball? Where did I go wrong? Oh, my people, what have I done to you? What did I do to you? Why are you the way that you are? Why are you no longer on fire for me? Why are you not living completely with your heart completely to me? And how have I wearied you? How did I make you tired, okay? How did I exhaust you? How have I not supported you that you may live for me? Didn't you know that we have been blessed with every spiritual blessing in the heavenlies? It's all yours. Your position is great, but your practice, your walk is horrible. And here he says, listen, and how have I wearied you? And he says, listen, I want you to call me out on it. Testify against me. Go ahead. Tell me, what did I do wrong? And then he says, before I do that, I want to bring up some witnesses. And I want to bring up some evidence to show you before you plead your case. Oh, for I brought you up from the land of Egypt. First witness, who's my witness and also my evidence at the same time, is the land of Egypt. I brought you up from the land of Egypt. And that's a symbol of salvation. I want you to know you were dead in your trespasses, and I saved you. I've given you, I didn't heal you from a disease. I've given you life from death. I've done a miracle in your life. For I brought you up from the land of Egypt. That's the first thing I've done for you. He says, but that's not all I've done for you. He says, listen, the next thing I did, I redeemed you from the house of bondage. By the way, it's not like you were there in Egypt having a party, you know, hanging out. You're so rich. You've got everything that you've got. You actually were miserable in Egypt. You were in bondage. You were a slave. You know, the funny thing is when you see the Israelites in the 40 years, when they kept complaining and complaining and complaining and complaining to Moses till they made the guy just like lose it, they complained. They're like, oh, we should go back to Egypt. Why? Oh, because we had this and that, which all the things that they mentioned, they're hallucinating. They never had those things. They're making it up. They're like, oh, it's better off over there than the wilderness. Actually, the wilderness is way better than anything else that you've ever had. He says, listen, you guys, not only did I save you, but I also given you a better life. I've given you a life that is not in bondage anymore. You're no longer a slave. And I freed you from the Egyptian. And he says, oh, by the way, that's my second witness and my proof, my evidence. But that's not all I've done for you. Let me take you. Let's bring up witness number 3.000, because it's witness number 3. What is it? And I sent before you Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. I saved you. I took away your bondage and I've given you freedom.
But I didn't say, ah, good luck, find your way. But I've given you some godly leaders who can hear my voice really well to guide you and to watch over you and to care for you. I would not leave you to be lost and alone in a scary wilderness. Witness number three and evidence number three. He says, but I'm still not done. Let's bring up the fourth evidence. Oh, my people, remember now what Balak, king of Moab, counseled. And here he goes to evidence number four. He says, listen, guys, you became saved. You came out of Egypt. And then I set you free. And then I set people to lead you. But while this happened, there was something else going on that you had no idea about. There was this man named Balak who had every ill will toward you. And he actually hired a guy to curse you. Spiritual warfare that you don't even know is happening, and it's about you. And its purpose is to curse you. And he did this three times. He tried in three different places to cause a curse to come upon you. And I see that warfare that is happening, this demonic stuff happening behind the scenes that you are so clueless about, where Satan is just trying to get you and do some really hard, harsh stuff. And you're like, ha, 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 ha. And you don't know what's happening, but it's happening. It's real. And I took care of him. And I took care of you in the middle of that. Even the spiritual warfare you're not even aware of. Very evil, demonic, dark stuff coming your way. I was there and I intervened for you. Witness number and evidence number four. He says, I'm still not done. I've got number five coming. And he takes us to number five. And what Balaam, the son of Beor, answered him. And so here what Balak did is he hired Balaam to be the prophet, the seer who curses them. And three times he would set up, and three times Balaam ends up blessing them. Not only did I stop this demonic evil stuff that's happening behind the scenes, but I actually took it and I turned it to a blessing for you. I blessed you. Oh people, what have I done to you? And how have I wearied you? Testify against me. Five things. Is this enough? Still not enough. I still did more stuff for you. What else have you done, Lord? He says, from Acacia Grove to Gilgal. And you're like, what are you talking about? Anyone knows what Acacia Grove to Gilgal, what that means? Basically, he says, not only did I stop a curse, but then I also turned that curse to a blessing, but I also did something else. As I took you and I crossed you over the Jordan River. So not only did I turn your curse to a blessing, but I also made you cross that deadly river, which represents death. And I took you through a very difficult trial, and I took you to the other side, but I didn't stop at taking you to the other side. I took you all the way to Gilgal. Number seven is Gilgal, where I took you, and I've given you blessing. I've given you the promised land. Now you have entered into the promised land. Oh, people of Israel, what's going on? Oh, people of God, look at these seven things I've showered you with in your life that I keep doing and doing and doing. And why are you in the state that you're in spiritually? Why is it that you take one step forward and a bunch back? Why are you not on fire for me? Oh, my people, what have I done to you? And how have I wearied you? Testify against me. That you may know the righteousness of the Lord. I want you to know how good I am and how precious you are to me and how important you are and how I've cared for you throughout your journey, throughout this very difficult journey that you've been going through. And I'm not done. I'm still here. I'm still watching over you and caring for you. Why are you in the state that you're in? And obviously, here you have some pretty solid evidence, don't you think? That support his complaint, and then now Israel responds in verse 6 and verse 7. And the response is so horrible because they can't argue his points,
But then they respond in a way that's very sad. I'll read them, and then I'll just say it in one word what it means, and then we'll go a little bit more into it. With what shall I come before the Lord, and how myself, and bow myself before the high God? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, 10,000 rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? So Israel knows. She's caught red-handed. She's a sinner. She's gone far from the Lord. And her answer, her response to all this is, how much? How much? What do you want? What do you want to get off my back, Lord? What do you want, some worship? Here you go. You want some stuff? Here it is. You want some sacrifices? You got it. Okay? Just get out. That's the response of Israel to the Lord. No wonder he's angry. With what shall I come before the Lord? Israel responds, I don't know. What should I do? He says, and bow myself before the high God. Oh, sounds like so good. He says, here's what I'm going to do. Shall I come before him with burnt offerings? Let me bunch of sacrifices. Hello, you're in the wrong, Israel. You know, Christian 101, you know, basics of walking with God equals repent when you do something wrong. No. I'm going to give him a bunch of burnt offerings. And then here he says, shall I come before him with burnt offerings? Like, okay, I went to church, okay? I read in the Bible, all right? Are you happy now? I sing, I do this, I do that. And so here, I come before him with burnt offerings. He says, you know what? I don't think that's enough. So you know, let me give him something more. Maybe it'll make the Lord be quiet. With calves a year old. Oh, it's a year old. I timed it. It's just right what you like. Here it is. And the things that Israel is offering him is good or bad, by the way? Good or bad? It's good stuff. Does God want these things or not? Yes or no? He does. But he just doesn't want it in this attitude. He doesn't want it with this heart. He says, I want you to give me these things. I want you to do these things. But I want you to be very different on how you do it. And how you give me that. And how you offer me these things. It's not just to be like, okay, I've done your check mark. I read in the Bible today. Check mark, I prayed today. Check mark, I did something nice to someone today. Check mark, I prayed for somebody today. Check mark, I preached today. Check mark, I did worship today. Check mark, I played this today. No. It's about a worshiping God. And so they go, you know what? I don't think he's going to get off my back. Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams? Maybe it's quantity that he needs. What's going to please him? Just how can he get out? Get away. Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams? They're like, I go back to Solomon's days. He did thousands. He killed thousands. Maybe that pleases the Lord. Let me do quantity. Let me go, instead of going to church one day a week, I'm going to go 7 days a week. It's not, you missed the point, people. No, maybe not thousands is enough. 10,000 rivers of oil. I mean, like, it's a river of oil, and then not a thousand, not thousands, 10,000s of it. Ah, here you go. Symbol of the Holy Spirit, here you go. I've had the Holy Spirit. Because you claim it doesn't mean you have. Like, what are you talking about, man? Oh, I don't think he's going to budge. Let me give him something even more precious and more expensive. Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression? I think he liked Abraham in that test he did in Genesis, where he says, offer me your firstborn son. I mean, your one and only son whom you love, Isaac, on a mountain. Maybe if I give you my firstborn, I'll kill my firstborn. God doesn't want human sacrifice. Are you crazy? These people went cuckoo because they don't know anything in the Word of God. So they offer him my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul. So, transgression. Okay, here's my firstborn. Offering to you. I've got sins. The fruit of my body, my kids, for the sin of my soul. And then Micah's like, okay, stop, guys, because you just messed up in court. God has a problem with you.
And your response is terrible. I want you to know God is not wishy-washy. He's not like, nah, you know, I think what I really like. You know, have you ever met someone like that? Like, just tell me what you like. You know, it's like, it could drive you crazy. Like, oh, you know, have you ever met the moody people? Like, you're like, oh my goodness. Like, it's like, Lord, can someone else deal with them? You know, you don't know. Like, today, the same thing might make him happy. The next day, it's like, you don't know. But God's not like that. He's very clear. He says, let me tell you, he has shown you, oh man, what is good. God has shown you, people of Israel, what is good. He has shown you. It was very clear before you. And what does the Lord require of you? And then he says, he told you very clearly what the requirement is. And in case you forgot, in case you are not sure, I'm going to tell you what it is. And I'm going to be very simple, very easy, so you can know what it is that God wants of you. Believers, if you have these three things, that's what he wants. Oh, three things? Yep. Simple. Is it like weird to understand it? No, very simple stuff. That's what the Lord wants. What are they? But to do justly is number one. Number two is to love mercy. Number three, to walk humbly with your God. That's it. That's all the Lord wants. And he's very clear about it. And that's why he says, he has shown you, oh man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you? And then he says his requirements. Nice to give me your worship in the way that you've been doing. What you're giving is good, but the way, not in the way that you're doing. What you're giving is good, but the way that you're giving is horrible. It's not like I can't see right through it. Others might not, but I see it. I want you to do justly, I want you to love mercy, and I want you to walk humbly with your God. To do justly means I want you to be fair. I want you to love justice. I want you to go with the truth. Follow the truth of the Word of God and apply it to every situation, to everything that you do. That's the first thing I want of you. The second thing is I want you to love mercy. Okay? I don't want you to like it. I don't want you to occasionally, you know, meet up with mercy. No, I want you to love mercy. And the thing is, these three things are impossible to do unless I have a true relationship with God. This is for believers. To love mercy means I have to have received mercy myself. And you guys know what's the difference between grace and mercy, right? What's the difference between grace and mercy? Right? Yes, getting something that you don't, not getting what you deserve, right? So let me say it out loud again. So grace is you get what you don't deserve, and mercy is you don't get what you deserve. Okay, well, that could mean be very taken very badly if not clarified, okay? Grace means you get what you don't deserve, okay? Which, you know, some people could say, well, you know, I went to prison and it was not fair. And I did not do any crime. Is that grace? Because you got what you didn't deserve, right? That's not what grace means. Grace means you got something good when you didn't deserve it, okay? Mercy, on the other hand, is you don't get what you deserve. So it's not like, you know, I worked for 10 hours, you know, and I make $10 an hour, and then at the end, my boss wouldn't give me my money. That is not mercy, okay, because you didn't get what you deserve. Mercy means you don't get something bad that you deserve. So let's apply it to spiritual stuff. Very simple. Grace is I deserve hell, period, just by being born. And if I receive God's mercy, God says because of my salvation, because of you repenting and you accepting the work I've done and you are being saved, I will not give you hell. That's his mercy. Grace says, I take it another step where I'm going to take you to heaven, which you don't deserve, because you deserved hell in the first place. I'm going to give you heaven when you didn't deserve it. And so here, God wants us to love which one? Mercy. To love mercy. You know, to love grace is easy. We all love grace. But the thing is, you can't really grace somebody. None of us are in that level. We're not God. You know, you can do forms of grace, but it's really lame grace. Whatever you and I can do to somebody else. But here I want you to love mercy. have mercy.
Last night we had a nice Bible study, and we were talking about the Samaritan woman. And the Samaritan woman, Jesus goes to her, and he's getting her attention. And then she's ready. She's like, give me this water. She's ready to take that next step of salvation. He says, bring your husband. And she was very smooth, very slick, very good. She's like, you know, I'm not going to lie to this man. I don't have a husband. She's not lying. And Jesus' answer is so beautiful. Let me read it to you real quickly just to see how awesome, but we're coming back to Micah. In John 4, Jesus answered, said to her, you have well said, I have no husband. Good job. But then he goes further. He says, for you have had five husbands, and the one whom you now have is not your husband. In that you spoke truly. Twice he's saying good job to her, and she is living worse than having a husband. She's went through five, and now she decided marriage is not for her, so she's gonna live with a man outside of marriage, but do the things that are supposed to be under marriage. And so Jesus, in the beginning, he affirms, he says, you have well said, I have no husband. So good job. And then at the last part of the statement, he says, it says, in that you spoke truly. But the thing is, lady, you've skipped a big portion about your life that you're hiding. And the thing is, unless you come to face that part of your life, you can't be saved. Unless you realize you're a sinner in need of a Savior, you can't be saved. But the thing is, you and I might say, oh yeah, you're right. You don't have a husband because you are an adultering, fornicating scum. That's what you are. That might be what comes out of our mouth. Be like, yeah, we know what you're about, lady. But here you see, he is the merciful one. He says, love mercy. And the thing is, because he still addressed her issue, but he did it in a merciful way, she went to that next step. She tried to actually kind of wiggle her way out of it. Oh, what is worship? Start to talk religion. He's like, no, get back here. And then he called her out on her religion. He says, what you're worshiping is wrong. And he did what a lot of people won't do. If you talk to somebody who's of a wrong faith, we sometimes like, oh yeah, and we dance. No, you have to call it out. It is wrong. There's only one way to get to heaven. And that's what he said. He says, you guys worship what you don't know. What you do is wrong. But we know what we worship. Salvation is of the Jews. Then he talked about what true worship is, which is worshiping in spirit and truth, which is basically what the Lord's problem is here in Micah 6. Love mercy. You have to have experienced mercy. But then he wants you to love it, that you give it to others. Have mercy on the person in front of you when you talk with them. Even if you have to have a very difficult conversation, be merciful. Be merciful. The third thing is to walk humbly with your God. I want you to not just, he doesn't say, he doesn't say, I want you to walk with your God. No, I want you to walk humbly with your God. You're not the boss. You're not the one who just pushes him and takes him wherever you want. No, he's not walking with you. You are walking with him. And you are walking with him under his authority, submitting to him, and you walk humbly with your God. He's your personal God that you walk with. Now I'm ready to receive your worship. Now I'm ready to have you come to me and offer me the burnt offerings, to offer me the calf a year old, to offer me the rams. And now I'm ready to reveal myself to you. I'm ready to fill you with the Holy Spirit. I'm ready to reveal to you things that you never knew before. Now I'm ready. But you have to do these three things. Do justly, walk in the truth. I want you to love mercy. Be merciful with others. And I want you to walk humbly with your God. Does anyone remember somebody that they're famous for walking with God? That's right, Enoch. Do you know how much scripture is written about Enoch? Is it a lot or a little? It's very little. Do you know in how many books you could find the mentioning? So, two. Okay, let's look at it real quickly, and we're going to come back to Micah 6, and we'll end. In Genesis 5, sorry. And I think, let's go from verse 21. Enoch lived 65 years and begot Methuselah. So, at what age did he have his son? His first son? 65. And his son's name is Methuselah. After he begot Methuselah, Enoch walked with God. So for 65 years, what did he do? Huh? He just lived whatever Enoch wants. He did his thing, right? And then after he got his son, he's like, And I want you to know, kids change you. Hopefully for the better. Most people it does. Kids change you because you're like, wow. Kids repeat everything. You know, my wife, she teaches at a school, and she has a little kids. And, you know, sometimes she tells me some really funny stories, you know. Like, the parents would be like, oh, sorry, we're late, you know, because of, you know, we had this thing, and then that thing, and then, you know. And I'm like, oh, it's okay. And then the kid's like, no, my mom didn't wake me up. Or they'll just tell them right on. They'll be like, call them out right on it. And then the parent looks, you know, you're going to believe the kid, not the parents. And he realized, you know, there's something more to life than Enoch. And now I have a family. I have a wife, yeah, but now I have a kid also, who God has entrusted me to raise. How do I want to raise this kid? Oh, well, if you ask anyone of Christian, you know, especially Arab Christians, you know, what do you want your kids to be like? I want them to be in the Lord. And then half the time, these people don't even go to church, don't even open the Bible, don't even own a Bible. Like, okay, I'm sure that's going to happen. Like, really? You know, I had a talk one time with a person. I said, you know, you kind of don't come to church, and I'm not aware of you going to any other churches. How do you expect your kids to, and he wasn't expecting me to, like, call him out like that. He's like, you know, I want you to ask about my kids. I said, yeah, I'd like you to be an example to your kids too. He's like, what? I said, I'm really ashamed. It's really shameful how you live and how you do these things. He's like, you know what? You're right. I said, I challenge you. Be an example, and I'll do my part too. So Enoch says, you know what? I'm going to be an example to my kids. So Enoch walked with God. And he walked with God for 300 years. He says, man, I can't believe I wasted 65 years of my life. Walked with God for 300 years and had sons and daughters. And then he says, I'm ready to have even a bigger family. Sons, daughters. Because now they could see God in my life. And they can model that. And they could see that. And they could live for God as well. And so, and then sons and daughters. So all the days of Enoch were 365 years. Well, it's a long life. Well, not compared to the others in that chapter, but it's pretty long to us. And Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. Twice in three verses that he says that Enoch walked with God. You see, sometimes we walk with God, but it's temporary. It's just until, like, Lord, I'm going to walk with you until you get me through this difficult time, through this bad thing, through this tough mountain that is facing me. I walk with you. Once the mountain is gone, forget it. I'm going to do my thing. But he says, no, I'm going to walk with God. And I'm going to continue to walk with God. I'm going to walk with him. I'm committing my life to him, to walk with him day and night till the end of my life. For 300 years, he walked with God. And then we come toward the end of his life at age 365. Verse 24, and Enoch walked with God and was not. And he was not, meaning what? He's gone. What happened? For God took him. You know what happened was this. So Enoch, what you doing, Enoch? He wakes up in the morning. So he's walking. He goes, he gets up, and he starts walking. Where are you going? I'm going for a walk. You want me to come with you? Maybe later.
You going with anybody?
Yeah, I don't see anybody. No, no, there's somebody.
I'm walking with God.
So he went, he took a walk with God. He took a walk with God. He took a walk with God, and he just kept getting more and more intimate with God, more and more intimate with God. And then he said, you know what?
One day, God is like, hey, so Enoch, how do you like this walk with me? He says, oh, I like it a lot. He's like, well, you know, do you want to like go home and get up and come back? He's like, well, what's on your mind, Lord? He's like, well, do you want to just like take it on from here, like all the time, no going home anymore? He's like, what do you mean? He's like, do you want to be, and he was not? What do you mean? Like, just come home. You mean like I die? No, just like, and he's a symbol for the rapture. He's like, let me tell my wife, no, my kids, no, let's go. And Enoch was not. And he went with the Lord. His wife didn't panic. They're like, where's Enoch? Well, he always walks with God. What happened? Well, he was not. But you know what? You see beauty, the beauty of Hebrews 11. You know, if you've never read that chapter, please read it. But here's how you read it. You read that chapter for God's perspective, God's opinion of what is considered high faith, what is considered good faith. Okay, because the thing is, when you ask somebody like, you see there's multiple people mentioned there, but there's 10 of them that are mentioned by name and action. And so if you don't know it, you know, we can kind of tell you the names, and then you kind of like, if you know the Word of God, tell us, what do you think is that highlight that God saw is considered really good faith? And the shocking thing is, a lot of times it's not going to be what we see there. And some of the things that God, like, really, that was faith? Yeah, and he saw it. God sees things very differently. Just to see it through his camera, and it's so encouraging. Because some of the things are like, wow, Lord, really? He says, yes. And this will encourage you to be like, you know what? He sees something really great in each one of us. So Hebrews 11, let me just read you just one verse, maybe two. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 5. By faith, Enoch was taken away so that he did not see death. So here we know for sure he didn't die. So Enoch was taken away. What made him be taken away? His faith, right? It's not because he walked with God. He walked with God, but he had something, a really cool material with him called faith. He walked with God with faith. By faith, Enoch was taken away so that he did not see death and was not found. So they looked for him. They went, they sent a search party for the guy, and he forgot to go home and tell them, you know, okay, I'm not coming back this time. And so he was not found because God had taken him. But he says, no, I want you to know it wasn't just like haphazard, just by luck. No, I'll tell you what happened. For before he was taken, he had this testimony. What's the testimony? That he pleased God. God was so pleased with him, he says, I can't let you go home anymore. I want you home with me. I want you to be with me. I want you to hang out with me forever. You want to be that? Sure. Amen. Let's go. He pleased him. That he pleased God. I don't know, man, but that would be an awesome title to get. The thing that the camera of heaven, the God's camera, and the measurement of God's camera says that put your name there, pleased God. Oh, that title. Then the next verse, but without faith, it is impossible to please him. And we found out that really what happened was he had faith, he trusted God. And that's why he says, you know, I trust God with my wife. I trust God with my children. So I'm just going to live for you, Lord, and I'm not going to worry about them because they are in your hands. They are entrusted to you. You're going to take care of them. And I tell you, you know, there's, you know, I know, you know, I don't know if you know any widows, but I know of some that you really look like, wow, it looks like this is not, they're not going to be okay. They have, you know, the ladies left and there's children. You're like, what's going to happen? But man, God is faithful. God, he had faith in God. And I know someone really dear to me, and you know, I was actually asking him, he was very ill, and I said, hey, aren't you afraid, you know, what's going to happen to your wife and kids?
And he's like, no. I said, not even like a little bit. Like, I was really close with him. He's like, no. I said, why not? He said, because God's going to take care of them. And God did when he went to be with the Lord. And so here we see that faith, walking with God, he walked humbly with God. Back to Micah chapter 6, verse 8. He has shown you, O man, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? It's a requirement. It's not like, oh, please, you know, or consider these things. These three things are a must before you come worship me. Or else I'm really annoyed. I'm bothered. I want you to know that I have a complaint against you. And how you've been coming to me, and how you've been serving me, and how you've been worshiping me, and how you've been living for me. I have a complaint against you. But if you do these three things, I want you to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. And then he ends the, and I'm going to take maybe 5 minutes to end this chapter. He ends with, he says, listen, if you're still not convinced, and you don't want to come approach me this way, and you really want to sin, I want you to know that there's consequences to sin. And he says here, the Lord's voice cries to the city. And here we see the beginning of the chapter. Hear now what the Lord says. He starts out by speaking. And then here he's coming, before you want to do these sins, I want to have done my fair warning of you. I'm going to cry out now to the city. The Lord's voice cries to the city. Wisdom shall see your name. The wisdom, she's what God is saying, sees his name. Hear the rod. Okay, I've got a rod in my hand, and I want you to listen, okay? I'm being very serious here. There's some serious consequences. If you have this attitude, I'm just going to sin, and he's just going to forgive me. That is the wrong attitude, wrong behavior to come toward me. We talked a little bit about that on Friday. Hear the rod, who has appointed it? And by the way, I've appointed this rod to do these consequences that we're going to talk about. So think twice. Don't take it easy with sin. Are there yet the treasures of wickedness? You got all this stuff, but it's evil. In the house of the wicked, in evil people's houses, he says, I'm not happy. And the short measure that is an abomination, and then the scale when you use it to do business, you end up not giving people what they really, you know, the money that they paid you. You don't give them what they're supposed to get for that money because you have fake scales. He says, it's an abomination. You upset me with this. Shall I count pure those with the wicked scales? You think because you were able to trick the person in front of you, rip them off in whatever nice manner it is, that I'm going to be okay with that? And you hear crazy stories of people ripping people off that is just like, wow. Take advantage of them because they don't know what they're going through or they don't know what they're doing. I don't know if you've ever signed contracts and stuff. It is some crazy stuff, you know. So we bought a house. I signed all these papers. And then we refied the house like a couple times. And you sign all these papers. And then, you know, so the people get annoyed with me a little bit because you get like a stack this big. And I'm like, sign here. I'm like, you're for all you know, it says you're giving me your house. Thank you for your donation. You don't know. And I'm telling you, even if you know English, it's really hard to see all these. It's like crazy. It's like after a while, in the beginning, I started reading, and I could tell that, that poor person, the one that has the notary. The notary is like, oh, this is going to take forever. And then after a while, I'm like, I can't. I just hope I'm not signing something away. And I'm like, sign, sign, sign. I'm like, I wish my signature was shorter because it get tired. He says, listen, guys, if you are impure on your end and you're ripping people off and they don't know it, that doesn't make it okay with me. I will not stand for that. And with the bag of deceitful weights, you got all kind of different fake measures. It looks like it weighs this much, but it doesn't. You're ripping people off. Listen, if you do bad business and you rip people off, even if they walk with a smile thinking they got a deal, I don't accept it. For her rich men are full of violence. And then the rich people, they're not ripping people off. They're actually being violent. They're harming people in physical ways. He says, I don't accept those rich people. her inhabitants have spoken lies, and then they, after this violence, they start speaking these lies, and their tongue is deceitful in their mouth, and they're ripping them off, they're lying to them, they're doing all these things, and they're getting away with it. He says, that is unacceptable, people. Therefore, I will also make you sick by striking you. I'm telling you, before you think about it, before you do it, I'm going to make you sick. I'm going, the rod is coming after you with an illness. I will also make you sick by striking you, by making you desolate because of your sins. You who rip people off, I'm going to rip you off myself. If you don't believe me, you know, look at the story of Israel when they came out of the land of Egypt. It's really, God is funny. He's really funny and he knows how to get even. But it's his job to get even, not ours, okay? Love mercy, guys. So the Egyptians, you know what? The Israelites, what was their salary in Egypt? Nothing. They were what? Slaves. Were they doing a lot of work for the Egyptians? Free labor. Does God like deceitful weights and, you know, free labor? You make somebody work, you don't pay them? No, he doesn't. So you know what God did? God kept track. And he kept track for 430 years. So they owed him a lot of money. So at the end, you know, plague one, plague two, plague three, plague 10. And then he's like, oh, guys, so tonight, you're out of here. Setting you free. Remember, that was the first witness, right? That God brought. He says, I'm going to get you out of here. But before you get out, I need you to do something for me. He says, what? Israelites, go to all the Egyptians and tell them, hey, do you got some gold? You got some jewelry? You got some bling? And so they went. And to their surprise, they're like, here, you know, they were like fed up with like here, whatever you want. So they gave them all the stuff. God paid them back. And he's like, okay. And then he says, before you leave, you're going to rip them off. And it's really God paying them back for what they had done to them. And so here he says, listen, guys, I'm not going to have it. I'm going to make you sick. I'm going to make you desolate. If you rip people, I'll make you lose your stuff. And then he says, there's this other thing that no one else knows how to do but me. And it is not pretty. So please think twice if you're thinking of sinning and you're taking it lightly to sin. He says, you shall eat, but not be satisfied. You're going to have a disease. You eat, like I'm hungry. You just ate. I don't know. I'm hungry. And you feel it. It doesn't feel good to be hungry. So can you imagine that? Hunger shall be in your midst. Like right there. That's all it is, hunger. You may carry some away, but shall not save them. And what you do rescue, I will give over to the sword. So you start, okay, this thing, I'm going to protect this thing. I'm going to take this thing. So, gone. You can't keep anything. You shall sow, but not reap. The normal law of humanity that God made is what you sow, you reap. You're going to sow, you're not going to get anything. You keep watering, nothing. Whoa. You shall tread the olives, but not anoint yourselves with oil. Tread. What's the expected thing? Some oil comes out. There's no oil. You make sweet wine, but not drink wine. You can't enjoy it. For the statutes of Omri are kept. All the works of Ahab's house are done. Does anyone remember a guy named Ahab? Huh? Yeah, who is he? King of Israel. Good or bad king? Bad. How about Omri? Who's that guy? Wow. I'm impressed. You're right, Josh. That's his dad. Good or bad guy? Bad guy. They're worse than each other. The worst two kings that ever existed in Israel are those guys. And what did they do? The statutes of Omri are kept. And Omri is the first one that started idolatry, worshiping idols. They're his statutes. They kept it. And then the works of Ahab, he was the most evil guy that killed people, got rid of anyone in his way. And the works of Ahab's house are done. That's what you guys are doing. And you walk in their counsels. That's like, oh, those are your advisors. That's what you live by. That I make you a desolation.
I'm not going to have it. I'm not going to accept that kind of walk. It's not okay to live in sin and then come, but he's going to forgive me. He forgives you, but the thing is you have to have true repentance. As we talked about on Friday, I'm not going to spend time to mean what it means to confess our sins. Therefore, you shall bear the reproach of my people. So God has a question for us, and I'm done. The question is, oh, my people, what have I done to you, and how have I wearied you? Testify against me. God is asking to this question to every believer in this room, to all of us, saying, how is your walk with me? Like, be honest. You don't have to make it prettier than what it is. And you don't have to tell anyone else in this room about it. But how is your real walk with me? Are you on fire? Are you worshiping me? Is your walk with me has worship that is under these three satisfied requirements of mine, that you are doing justly, you love mercy, and you walk humbly with your God? You're humble with me. You obey me. You trust me. And because of that, that's the attitude of worship that you come and live with me. Are you on fire or not? And if the answer is no, God has a question for us. Oh, my people, what have I done to you? What did I do? How have I shortchanged you? And how have I wearied you? Can you tell me where I went wrong? Testify against me. And he says, in case you don't remember, I want you to know how good I have been to you. I saved you. I took away your bondage. And I sent people to lead you and to guide you in the right direction. And I have blocked. I have taken away things that you don't even know. You know, I love, there's a guy named Magdi Samuel, really has been a great mentor to me. He's with the Lord now. And he said one time something that really hit me hard. He says, you know, if God revealed to us everything that could have hurt us, we'd be so traumatized, we couldn't get out of the house. He says it's from God's goodness that sometimes he doesn't even let us know the things that he protected us from and how bad it was. Because the thing is, imagine you're walking down the street, okay? And then a car is going to come and hit you, okay? And then you are saved from that. You might be so traumatized you're afraid to cross the street again. Ever. But the thing is, maybe God protected you from a car that was going to come across the street, but you didn't see it. You didn't know what happened because he didn't want you to be traumatized so you could still be able to cross the street and not be afraid. And he says here, guys, not only have I saved you, not only have I set you free, not only have I set people in your life to lead you and to guide you in the right way and to give you the truth, but I have also protected you from things you don't even know how bad they are. Curses, demonic, evil, dark stuff that really exists, it really does today. And I protected you from that. And I didn't just do that. I actually took it and then I flipped it against them. And I turned it into a blessing in your life. And not only that, I have also taken you through some serious trials, the trials of death, the Jordan River. And not only that, but I've also given you blessings upon blessings in your life. I've given you a promised land. I've given you my will and my purpose in your life. And I'm allowing you to live it to the fullest. I'm a good God. What have I done to you, O my people? And how have I wearied you? Testify against me. I really pray that we come before him and say, Lord, if I'm not on fire, you're not the criminal, but I am. And I want to come in repentance. I don't want to come and buy you off with some nice sweet words that I can come up with, but I want to come and in true repentance worship you and honor you in my life. I want to come in true repentance. I want to come and have the right heart, the right demeanor, the right attitude, the right motives, the right way that is pleasing to you. I want to be walking by the truth, just. I want to do justly. But I also want to love mercy because you have had mercy on me. But I also want to walk with you humbly. I want to follow you. You take the wheel. You lead. And I'm going to come. I'm going to follow you humbly, obey you. And then I'm going to give you that worship that is pleasing to you. I want to walk with you by faith, trusting you like Enoch did. that I want to hear that word. And he, before he was taken, that it was written about him that he pleased God. Let's spend a few minutes in prayer, and if anyone wants to pray out loud.